Thank you, Sarah, Luke, and welcome to everybody, and thank you for coming to listen to our story. Yeah, we are new on the block, Advanced Energy. We started a year ago, and as you see on this introductory slide, one of our key themes is looking for hidden value in existing assets. So let me just move on to pass the disclaimer, which I don't think we need to deal with in too much detail. And go to the slide 4, which is the corporate overview. I'm going to try and run through this fairly quickly, and kind of more interested to get to the question and answer stage, and we can talk a lot more about the ins and outs. But it's true, we rebranded a failing company in February 2020, with a new team and a new board. And we do indeed have quite a significant amount of experience, and that's what we're bringing to the party. We do think that we're a rather accomplished team, and we think we can back that up with our track record, which we see as something we've delivered over the years in numerous different places and different assets. And in fact, we have some case studies on our website where you can see where we truly did add value to assets that had been that hadn't been foreseen. And the directors and management also own 7% of the company right now after the RTO that you mentioned, Sarah. So we're very much invested in the company, and we aligned with our shareholders as a result. And the only thing I would just add before I move on, and I think it's an important point to perhaps make, that we started at the beginning of February, listed in the beginning of February, rebranded, and then a few weeks later there was an oil price crash, and about the same time there was a pandemic that started. So we had a pretty challenging issue with these two double whammies coming at us just after we started, and we certainly wondered whether we'd done the right thing. But things have turned out, and after a year, as you've pointed out, we've done our first deal, which I'm going to talk about a little more in a minute. We do think we have a novel E&P growth strategy. It's not what most people are looking to do. What we are doing is targeting discovered resources, and we are definitely not interested in exploration, certainly nothing that's high risk. We're looking at production, or we're looking at undeveloped fields, or production which can be enhanced, but it's always got to be to do with near-term cash flow, which provides from unrealized potential. And of course, like everybody, we like to look at high margin assets, and we typically like to focus on areas where we think the fiscal regime is particularly attractive. Non-operated is definitely one of our key strategy elements. We don't want to have a large team build up operating positions in different places in the world. We want to be nimble. We want to be able to go into a country, even if it's just got one asset, and we can quickly do that. There's an operator there, an asset we want to work with. And that comes to the other point, that we want to work with highly credible partners, normally people we have some knowledge of or have experience with working with, in order to minimize the risks of downside outcomes. And coming to the deal that we've done now, we brought a number of opportunities into the company with us, i.e. targets that we wanted to focus on and try to acquire. And the Buffalo farming was one of those key assets. And it's certainly very satisfying for us to have achieved that almost exactly a year after we launched the company, a little bit before if you count the time that we actually cut the deal at the end of the year. And on the back of that RTO, we raised nearly £22 million, and part of that money will be used to drill an appraisal well, and I'll talk about that in a minute. So what is the Buffalo field? The Buffalo field contains 2C oil resources of about 34 million barrels, which have been certified by a company called Risk. Might not be so familiar to people, but they are originally based in Australia, but also have an office in London. And we're partnering with a company called Carnarvon Petroleum that has a very extensive regional knowledge of West Australia up into East Timor, where this particular asset is lying. and they're a very highly capable operator, and we know quite a few of the parties in the company, on the board and in the technical team, because I lived down in Perth for 10 years and I have worked with some of these people in the past, which makes it all the more easy to communicate, not least in the current times where we have inability to travel. But the first well that we want to drill is an appraisal well. It's called B10, and that will be drilled in the second half of this year. And I'll give you some more detail on that as we go. It's a low risk appraisal well, stroke development well. And I'll explain what that means a little bit more as we go through. The buffer, and this PSC, this asset that's sitting in the PSC, has the potential for 40,000 barrels a day of gross production by the end of 2023, or possibly before if things go really well. And this is a very key aspect to this particular asset. In addition to this asset, just while we're on the subject of the strategy and what we want to do, we want to grow the company. We seek to establish a scale through a pipeline of existing acquisition targets. We have about four or five that we brought into the company, and we've added one or two extra ones in the last year that we're working on. So we're very active at looking to add more assets in the course of this year and obviously beyond. And an important aspect, of course, is the ESG initiative that's going on around the world at the current time, and most E&P companies are involved. And this is something that, with our long experience, we've been through various different, how should we say, evolutions of this approach to the way the oil and gas company works. And so we're very tuned into this latest evolution of that theme. So just moving on to slide five, here is a picture of the Buffalo Venture, which was on location in 1999 and 2004 on the asset when it was developed previously. I actually flew out to this asset because I was looking to lease a MODEC FPSO for Indonesia at the time, and this is a MODEC FPSO. So I spent a couple of days there. It's about a 4.5 hour flight out and a 4.5 hour flight back. And I have to say, Sarah, if you've never flown the helicopter and thought it was exciting, that doing that trip would kill you, would kill the idea forever. Just moving on to the next slide, a bit more detail on the farming highlights for Buffalo. We have an unoperated interest, which is in line with our strategy. It's a proven oil field because it produced before, and it's currently in offshore East Timor. The opera I mentioned is Carnarvon. They've capitalized about $330 million US. So they're a reasonably successful company, and they have a very large project that they're working with Santos on to bring on production. As I mentioned, risk certified, the Buffalo field gross 2C contingent resource at 34 million barrels. It's not a huge field, but it's a material volume of oil. And the potential gross peak production that I mentioned earlier, 40,000 barrels a day, is something that's readily achievable in the field from past performance. But if you combine these two, you can see that if we produce at 40,000 barrels a day, 34 million barrels, then we're very quickly going to deplete it. And that is exactly what we want to try and achieve here. This is about accelerated production and cash flow by producing rapidly a relatively small volume of oil. And in terms of the deal that we did, as you mentioned, we've actually done the RTO now, and we have secured 50% interest in the asset. It's a two-party joint venture, also a very key aspect of our strategy. We're paying 100% of the B10 appraisal well as part of the farm-in, which is going to cost somewhere around about $20 million. That's the AFE that we expect will be finalized in the coming weeks. Plus, we also agreed to secure the funding for 100% of the development capex to first oil. So in other words, we're carrying Carnarvon from now for the appraisal well through to first oil. It's a pretty unique situation. It's not a common thing that people might do, but it actually works out to be a very good deal for us based on the success of the field, of course. So the raising of the money was to de-risk this near-term high-return development project. That is to say, to drill the well and establish the future value of the project in terms of the reserves. And here's a couple of pointers in terms of the value that we're getting, we're expecting to get from the field once we've drilled the well and put it on production. The 1 year gross for the first year of free cash flow is nearly $300 million at $50 per barrel, based on the CPR economics generated by risk. And 70% of the gross revenue cumulative cash flow recovered is recovered in the first 2 years. So you see my point earlier about the size of the volume of oil and the rate that it can be produced at. We're getting this very large cash flow very early on in the field's life. A final point here that's just relates to the RTO. Both the chairman, Mark Rowlands, and myself, we subscribed a significant amount of money to the shares during the recent placing. So again, we're showing our commitment to the asset and belief in the asset and the future of the company. Moving on to slide number seven, a little bit of an overview of the field is probably appropriate at this point. So the history is that it was originally developed and operated by BHP and Nexen in 1999. That's to say, it was originally BHP and then they sold out to Nexen after a couple of years. It produced 21 million barrels over 5 years and achieved a peak rate of 45,000 barrels a day from only two wells. And it would then shut in late in 2004 at a rate of 4,000 barrels a day. And it's this aspect of 45,000 barrels from two wells, 20,000 barrels a day per well. And this is related to the high quality of the reservoir, the high quality of the oil, and there's also an infinite aquifer in this field to optimize the sweep and recovery of oil. If I just move to the location now, I don't want to spend too much time on this, but it's kind of interesting perhaps to explain what's going on. If you look at the shaded area in pink in the map, this is the block that was 523 in Australia that contained the Buffalo field. And you can see a sort of an L-shaped blue line, which is sort of at an angle. This is the new boundary between East Timor and Australia. And this was agreed a couple of years ago after a long time when there was a disagreement about what the maritime boundary should be. And that's finally been resolved. But the net result is that the Buffalo field, which is at the top of the right there, has moved into East Timor. And the rest of the block, which is 523, really remains in Australia. So this doesn't cause any problems. In fact, there are positives to this, and I'll mention a couple of them in a minute. So this all happened before we got involved, and for the moment now everything is resolved. There's a PSC in East Timor that's established, and we're all set to go ahead and drill this appraisal well this year. One of the benefits of the move is that we expect to get lower operating costs by working in Southeast Asia versus Australia. I worked in Australia, and of course, it's for world cost compared to costs in Southeast Asia, which are typically significantly lower. And the other important aspect was an agreement that the fiscal terms associated with any asset that moved from Australia to East Timor would retain the same fiscal outcome in the new regime. And so the PSC was improved in East Timor to provide the Buffalo field with the same fiscal terms as it would have had it stayed in Australia. So it is actually probably the best PSC in Southeast Asia as a consequence. This is a huge boost for and helps immensely with the recovering the cash flow that I mentioned. So when you might say, well, this field was developed before, over 5 years, competent operators. How is it that we're going back there again? Well, the operator saw an opportunity. They realized that, and this was the case at the time, that the seismic was very difficult to interpret because the field underlies a carbonate shoal. And there was lots of difficulty in locating the wells in the right place and being sure that they were going to do what they hoped to do. And there were a number of failures at that time, and it was all related to having difficulties establishing the correct geological model. 20 years on, Carnarvon realized there was an opportunity to license the field, use modern techniques for reprocessing, and better image the reservoir, and be able to delineate the undrilled crest, which had always been understood to be there, but had never been drilled. And that's exactly what's transpired. So they did a lot of work over a period of 2 years, that's Carnarvon, with this modern reprocessing approach. And they have indeed managed to delineate an undrilled crest. And the 2C remaining oil in place as a result of that is certified at 85 million barrels, which is not an inconsiderable volume of oil. So the forward plan for us is to drill an appraisal well prove up the remaining oil accumulation. And it's planned to drill in the crest of the structure towards the end of this year. And I was in touch with the operator just today, and we're very confident that we're going to be able to drill the well in certainly in Q3 this year and have the results before the end of the year. Once we've drilled the well and got the results, we'll recertify the resources to reserves, finalize the redevelopment plan, and take FID early in 2022 with a projected first oil date in the second half of 2023. So moving along to slide 8. But this is about the B10 appraisal well and just a little bit of information on how that's going to play out. If you look at the map, this helps perhaps some of the attendees to understand what's going on here. The shaded green area is the area that we have established, or Carnarvon has established, and we have reviewed it and taken it as being acceptable in terms of an interpretation. It shows the remaining oil that has not been drained from the previous development, with the B, and it says there, of course, undrilled attic or crest, depending on how you like to term it. And you can see that the Buffalo 10 well is sitting right smack in the middle in an area which is the highest on the accumulation. And that's the well we want to drill this year. And if we are successful, going back up to the text there, the 2C case would imply an 80 meter column. And that's what we're hoping to find when we drill the well. If it's more, that's so much the better. The well is going to be drilled vertical. It'll be on the carbonate shoal, which is 25 meters of water depth, so it's very shallow, and we will use a jackup. No complications or issue with the well design, very straightforward. There's many wells being drilled in this area. Understanding of drilling is well established. And once it's been drilled, we'll suspend it as a future producer and look to optimize the development plan, as I hinted on the previous slide. The drilling plan, as I said, will be a jackup because we're in shallow water. Environment approvals have been secured, and we've done the tendering, and we're very close to being able to contract the rig. It'll be happening probably in somewhere between 4 to 6 weeks' time, with a target spud, as I mentioned, towards the end of the year, now looking like it will be October-ish. It's a 30-day well, down to 3,400 meters, and the budget cost is $20 million US at the current time. Obviously, we'd like to think it will be less, but we'll see. In terms of risk, we've got 8 wells already penetrated on this, the E-line reservoir, and we've got the reprocessed seismic, which has enhanced the imaging. From our point of view, this makes the appraisal well low risk, with a high probability of encountering the undrilled crest to reveal the quantum of residual reserves to be developed. Here I want to talk a little bit about the redevelopment concepts very quickly. If you look at the two cartoons on the right, the first one shows the setup that was used by BHP, which is a wellhead platform in shallow water where the wells are drilled from, with an FPSO sitting out in 300 meters of water, moored there, with flow lines going up to the wellhead platform. That is the most likely scenario in the case that we have a 2C scenario, the 2C outcome, so the 34 million barrels. If we have an indifferent or a lesser outcome, we might look at something like MOPU, which is the scenario below, where the production facilities will be sitting on the MOPU itself. and we can drill from there, and we can do workovers if necessary. It's a more compact scenario. Then you have a dumb vessel, which is an FSO sitting offshore in a similar way to the FPSO. And it's a question of economics as to whether that scenario would work. But obviously, we're hoping for the bigger volume, and an FPSO in that case is definitely the most likely scenario. In terms of approach, three well development is what we're looking at. We don't need a lot of wells when you have high productivity. Probably a 4 or 5 slot wellhead platform with the leased FPSO. And if it's a MOPU, it would also be leased. Everything nowadays is leased. You don't buy these kind of vessels. It makes the economics much more attractive, and it's much more flexible for the operator. In terms of status and timing, location of the wellhead platform MOPU are identified. FID should be in about a year's time. That would be our objective. Schedule would typically be about 18 months. I've done two similar developments like this in the past, and it's very difficult to beat 18 months. BHP did it in 15 months, but I think we would be a bit arrogant if we thought as two small parties that we could achieve that for our first development. In terms of the CPR costs, the estimated costs were 125 million. Very, you know, within the range, and we're not uncomfortable with that. The metric of $4 per barrel of capex is a very respectable number for a development of this sort. So we think we're in a good place there. In terms of deliverables, it's important to understand. I work most of the fields surrounding Buffalo. All of them are now abandoned. But some of them had extremely high recovery factors. Laminaria is one that maybe people are familiar with. 60% recovery factor there. And our oil API is 53%. It's basically almost condensate. It's very light oil, and it's very attractive. It attracts a plus or minus $2 premium to Brent, which is extremely helpful. And we have this potential for the gross production to be up to 40,000 barrels a day at the start of production in the first year. And then another metric here, 63% of the reserves were produced in the first 2 years. And the life of the field related to that 34 million barrels and that high rate, relatively short, 5 to 6 years, we're in and out with all of the revenue stream essentially front-ended, because of the productivity of the field. So on to the last slide, our value proposition. As I mentioned at the beginning, we consider ourselves to be a pretty accomplished team with a very focused and somewhat novel strategy and a proven track record. Yeah, we have global E&P experience. We cover many countries. We're not planning to go to many, many, many countries. We're probably going to be focused on the Eastern Hemisphere and key countries that we have a certain penchant for in terms of future assets. We are very much aligned with our shareholders with the skin in the game that we have put in twice now. We recapitalized the company with £500,000 in February last year, and you know, the further equity participation recently on the placing. This is a transformational transaction. I mean, we were £3-4 million pound dollar company, and now we've more or less transformed that by a factor of 10 by doing this deal, which is a great outcome for ourselves in a very difficult year. We're looking for exceptional, you know, short, medium term value addition on that basis, certainly within 2021 by drilling the well. And the Buffalo transaction then provides this strong catalyst in the form of a low risk B10 well in 2021, and helps to provide us with this significant step change in company valuation with a solid platform for growth going forward.
Why don't we just leave that slide there, because you've overrun by 5 minutes, so I'd really like to get on those questions. But we can hold that slide, which encapsulates the compelling investment case. And right at the beginning there, you were telling me about that horrific 4-hour helicopter journey. No, you wouldn't catch me doing that. Why I didn't get the job as North Sound Radio's Eye in the Sky way back in 1991 when I worked on the radio station in Aberdeen. But that sounds, yeah, pretty hardcore, and hopefully you don't have to do too many on site.
Well, I'm looking forward to it because it means I'm getting out there.
Absolutely. So have you been like our previous few presenters who are increasingly frustrated by the fact that they are land bound, COVID bound, remote desk bound?
Well, curiously enough, we kicked off in February. Lockdown started in March, mid-March, and the oil price crashed about the same time. And we thought, oh my goodness me. But in reality, we sort of, well, because we're actually based, I'm in Geneva, two of my colleagues are in London, one is in Kiev, and the other one is in Perth in Australia. And we've been working this like that for a year, and two of us have never met.
Okay, well, maybe it's time that you did meet. But right,
the point is that we're making it work regardless.
Fantastic. With your 120-year collective years and experience. But in terms of that experience, I just want to, I'm going to come back to Buffalo because that's the crux of the presentation tonight. But plenty of people are asking about additional assets. So I'm just wondering, in terms of timing of new assets, non-Buffalo assets that you'll be bringing into the portfolio, I guess you are not looking to be the operator of any assets that you bring in.
No. The whole idea is to look for non-operated assets and almost certainly two-party joint ventures. So we have, I don't like to use the word control. So we are in a position to influence through constructive discussion and the presentation of ideas to maximize value. That's what we're all about. So no, we have several conversations going on at the moment, and I can honestly say that it would be very surprising if we didn't have two more assets by the end of the year.
Okay, and how will that be paid for? Because I'm looking at the research notes. Buffalo, any additional funding, hopefully, will be covered by debt finance, and you won't be coming back to the market at this stage of the development.
No, for the Buffalo, we're looking to probably do 70%. For the development itself, we'll be looking at doing 70% debt, 30% equity. Is the kind of ratio we're looking at here. Yeah.
Chris Aspley is impatient, as are most of the investors who join us on these forums. He says, why will it take until 2023 to produce oil, which is 18 months after the appraisal well?
Well, it's a pretty simple question. It's a pretty simple answer. That we're going to drill the well at the end of the year. It's a 30-day well. We have to log it and then recertify. Once we do the recertification, we have to finalize the FDP. After we've done the FDP, we have to get all the contracts in place and take FID. It goes in parallel with raising the or getting the funding that we've just talked about, the 70-30, right? So that takes some time. You can call it 6 months, plus or minus, yeah? If you do a field development like this offshore with the floating facilities, as I say, I've done one in Indonesia, which I mentioned earlier, done another one in West Africa, and I was involved in one in Vietnam as well. And whatever way you try to slice and dice it, it's very difficult to beat 18 months, and I'm hanging my hat on that we'll probably do it in 18 months. But if we're really slick, we might get it a little bit less than that.
I like what you did there. Bit of an energy metaphor, slick. Okay, Sadat Umar says, right, the specifics, please. When are you expecting to mobilize the rig and commence drilling? How long? He's asked three questions. How long will it take to reach the drill to total depth once it's spudded, and will there be any flow test after drill? So I'll broadcast that comment.
Okay. So look, as I mentioned, I was in conference call with the operator today. We've given them the $20 million, and we're doing a catch up on exactly where we're going with the contracting of the rig, etc. And it was very good news, in fact, because we've identified one rig, which is the most likely one that will be contracted. There are four wells to be drilled ahead of us by this rig, and we would then be the the fifth and final well before the rig returns to base before the cyclone season in that area. And we're quite pleased about that because it virtually confirms that we will drill the well in Q4 this year, where there was still a little bit of uncertainty about slots and so on and so forth. And being the last well to be drilled means, of course, that the drilling team will be at its most effective and most efficient. So we can expect to have a very good outcome in terms of the way the well is drilled, very smooth. In terms of the timing, the well will take about 30 days. And we're not going to shift on that because by the time you do all the rigging up and then spudding the well and drilling the well, we're going to do a comprehensive logging because we want to get as much data as possible. It's unlikely to be less than or much less than 30 days. Sorry, there's a third aspect to that.
Will there be any flow tests?
Have a flow test? No. Why are we not going to do flow tests? We're not going to do flow tests in a field that's produced 21 million barrels where we know the reservoir extremely well. We have all the parameters for the fluids. We have no need to do a flow test. A flow test is a luxury these days. If you do your logging well, and it's an unknown reservoir, normally a flow test doesn't add any value to the data acquisition and your need to have that data to optimize the development. What it does do is it gives a big flame, which tends to have a good impact on the share price.
And I'm very pleased to hear that. But something that does have an impact on the share price is the price of oil. So here you are, last February, emerging. Look at us. Here we are, advanced energy. But then you were hit with a double whammy of the oil price crash and COVID. However, you have more than survived. And I'm just wondering, should, and I'm not predicting this, I have no inside information, should we have another oil price crash? At what level would it be game over for Advance?
In terms of the Buffalo field?
In terms of Buffalo.
We have evaluated it to be economic as a development that you would be willing to FID and proceed with down to $30.
And for those new investors who don't know what FID means.
Oh, final investment decision.
Fantastic. Because so many of us are waiting for the final line of duty this Sunday that we've got accustomed to a certain amount of acronyms. So there you go. I'm going to end on a negative. It's up to you to spin it to something positive. What could go wrong?
What could go wrong? Well, we've got the money. We've got the rig. We've got the people. The well's going to get drilled. But we still have to find out what happens.
And in a year's time, the collective years of experience of the board will be even greater.
It will.
Utterly ridiculous. Okay. Leslie Peterkin, Chief Executive of Advance Energy. It's been an absolute pleasure and no four-hour helicopter journeys for you.
There will be eventually. I certainly hope so.
Okay.
Anyway, look, Sarah, thank you very much. It was the first time. It was very good. It was very interesting. And I look forward to doing it again.
I hope so, because my team, my gang, and those in the virtual room asking questions are certainly the best. It's been a pleasure. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.